Good morning.
Good morning.
We are going to conclude our series today, Getting the Most Out of the Bible. This is the fourth installment of the series, and what we're going to talk about today is understanding what we read. Here's the thing about the Bible. Some people will give you the impression that all you need to do is just read it, and your life will just change. And sometimes that does happen. But if you're anything like me, the first time you pick the Bible up and start reading it, you say, huh? What? Right, what in the world is the beginning? What is that all about? Right? And there's a lot of terminology that's unfamiliar. There's a lot of cultural things that go on there that you don't quite understand. If you're anything like me, maybe you're not. Maybe you're fire baptized from birth. You came out speaking Greek and Hebrew, and maybe I'm just the one that has to catch up. But if you're anything like me, the Bible sometimes doesn't make a lot of sense. I don't know. Yes? Am I in the right location? Okay. Good, because I'll go to the remedial Christian class then. I'll go speak there if y'all are all good. So we're going to talk about how do we understand what we read and give you permission to say, I don't get it. It's okay. Yes?
Yes.
Yes, it's okay. That's why there's lots of help for you. And we're going to talk about that. This message is going to be a little bit different than the others. I'm going to be doing less preaching and more teaching. I'm going to be showing you some resources, and hopefully it will be a blessing to you. Amen?
Amen.
So let's first review what we've talked about so far. Jesus is the interpretive key of all Scripture. The Bible helps us relate to God and others, but it is not a substitute for a relationship with God. The Bible is a life-giving book. However, we need to use the Bible as it was intended and for the purposes for which it was created. The Bible provides us with a way to spend time with God and should be approached with that perspective. That summarizes sort of where we've been. What else do you remember from the series? Anything else jump out at you? A point that you want to share or something God told you as we were talking about the Bible?
I think the piece that was most memorable for me is that when we've, you know, lots of us have gone through, you know, read the Bible through in a year, and we get into like the actual, like, being dutiful mm-hmm. about getting through the Bible as opposed to it being something that we maybe even go through a bit more slowly, but interact with God, and you know, and make, and that ends up being, you know, the relationship piece. And that's been really transformative for me.
Yes.
Because there's so many times, like we talked about, one of the times we were talking was about, like, you know, you'll usually read and be okay until you hit around like Numbers and Leviticus, and then people are like, I can't do it. But it's, you know, yes. But when we approach it from the perspective of interacting with God as we read, it's such a different experience. So
yes.
That's one of the things I remember most.
Yes, yes. Yeah, yeah, and communicating with God. Yeah. So many times I've said, God, I don't get what you just said right here. I'm not understanding this. I believe you could tell me, mm-hmm. and so I'm believing that you will. Mm-hmm. And he usually does. Actually, he always does. Mm-hmm. He provides the answer to when we ask him direct questions. It's pretty cool like that.
One
yes.
of the things I kind of extrapolated is this new GPS system that we have.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to get to my house and you've never been up there, you put it in the direction. The Bible is our GPS.
Yes. Yeah.
Because
yeah.
so many things that, like you say, the Greek and the Old English, and it's for the new aspect, for the Old English like me, I have an idea with the archaic, but the new people, I guess that's Greek.
Yeah, yeah.
King James English.
It's true, it's true. And so that is absolutely true. It's a GPS, and you don't need to have a background in Hebrew and Greek to get something out of the Bible. You just need the help of people who do. You just need the help of folks who do get that. And then you take that and use that. Because I think one of the things that I used to think was that the Bible was a boring book because I read it wrong. And I think what some of these aids and resources can help you is to see yourself in the story. And then it's like, whoa, this is crazy. I can't even imagine this going on. This is real. This is exciting. It's a very exciting book if you know how to read it. Go ahead, Teresa.
I appreciated the fact that, I think it was last week, sorry, when you said, I don't have to read my Bible to spend time with God.
Mm.
Because because some days it's not my top priority to read the Bible.
Yeah.
And then I feel bad because I didn't read the Bible.
No, yeah.
You know, but I do spend time with God, but it's not reading my Bible.
Right, right. Sometimes Jesus taught his disciples from the scriptures. Often he did. Sometimes they were just walking by a mountain. And he's like, you see this mountain over here? Let me tell you about this mountain. Right? And he'll use anything around him to teach. And I think he does the same thing. We still have that relationship with God. Well, where sometimes I say, you know what, God, I just want to see you as I walk somewhere. I want to see you in a walk. I want to look around and see you that way. And I'll see him. You know, he's everywhere, man. He digs that. He likes showing you new things. He gets excited. I think you're absolutely right. Connie.
I used to think, well, I think that a light bulb just went on about this relationship with God and reading the Bible. Mm-hmm. I don't look at the, I don't understand so much as a problem as a means to engage in more relationships
Amen.
With others, to
Amen.
Understand.
Amen.
And that's why I think I miss, and maybe many of us do, Bible study
yeah.
with others. Because
yeah.
that's that fellowship with each other and then with God.
That's mm-hmm. right. That's right. Church is so important to help them to understand the scriptures. Mm-hmm. And if you look through the Acts, I loved it. There are many times where they didn't really know what to do because new things were happening. Mm-hmm. And those decisions were made in a council of many people sort of sharing thoughts and ideas. And I think that's such an important part of understanding what we read. All right, anyone else? This is good stuff. I might not have to preach the sermon. I might just sit down. You guys are on a roll. All right. So let's get into what we're going to talk about today. And to do that, we're going to look at a passage that may seem unrelated to the topic, but I think it provides a wonderful example of how to engage the Bible. And we're looking at Acts chapter 17, and we're looking at verses 10 through 12. This occasion is on the second missionary journey of Paul. He and Silas are going around starting churches and checking in on churches that they started and preaching the gospel wherever they go. And they had to leave a messed up situation in Thessalonica. Mm-hmm. People got way out of hand. They just got crazy. They got a riot. So they're like, look, we got to get out of Thessalonica, man. It's crazy in there. They still got a church done. I mean, praise God. I mean, under those circumstances, folks trying to kill you, you still get a church. Praise God, you know. But, we got to get out of Dodge. Let's go to Berea. And so here's where we pick up the action. As soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now, the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. As a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. So what jumps out at you as something that the Bereans did that made them, as Luke says, more noble? What did they do?
Research.
Yeah. They studied the scriptures. Right? What else did they do?
Not only were they examined, but it says that they were eager.
Yes.
Right? And as a result of that, many of them believed.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Behind that, go ahead, Mike.
They're just sharing what they understood.
Yes.
Maybe others weren't getting it at the time.
Yeah, yeah. I think behind that is an assumption on their part that truth can be found in Scripture. They had an assumption that Scripture could speak to them about what's happening right now and give them guidance for their life. They believed that. And so they were eager to talk about these things that Paul and Silas were laying down, like, yeah, let's talk about this and see what's up with it. And then they went and they studied. They researched. And it was a plural. It was not just one dude sitting in a room with some dusty scrolls. It was the community sort of coming together and saying, what do we think God is saying about this? Very cool. Very cool. And so I think in that there's some modeling for us, where it talked about some of the things we talked about earlier in the series about the attitude in which we approach Scripture. the holding on to what it's good for, right? The trusting in it for what it's good for. The trusting in it to help guide us into relationship. And then the going to it regularly, wrestling with it. You know, not just sticking to the same psalms over and over again, but talk about some of the things that go deeper and might apply to the life that we're living in, the circumstances of our life right now. Amen? Mm-hmm. Questions, comments, thoughts on that? You with me so far?
Well, I'm definitely with you. Yeah. I was going to say, I think it's so refreshing to see that, because in a lot of other cases, like we see what happened in Thessalonica, was that, you know, Paul and Silas were there sharing, and then this group, you know, caused the riot and stirred up all that,
right,
you know, disturbance or whatever. But this was, like, they were really wanting to know more about what he was saying and weren't just, like, you know, sitting there and either just outright rejecting it or just taking it in and just believing it without examining. But they actually engaged with what
right.
he was saying and really immersed themselves in it.
Right.
So that's refreshing to see, because I feel like that's something that I get frustrated by that I see in our society nowadays, that people are either just way too quick to either accept or to reject something without being thoughtful
yeah.
about it.
Yeah.
So it's really refreshing to see how they approached it.
Right. And what I want to model from the Bereans, and this is something that I think about and I want us all to think about, do I really want to know God better? You know, I mean, how seriously do I take that? Do I think I know enough to get by? Do I think I know enough about God to, I'm fine, I'm good. Or do I have such a hunger and thirst for who he is that's going to send me back to the reservoirs of his presence? You know, am I going to continue to go back there and drink all that he is? All right, and the Bereans were hungry for him. They wanted to know more about him. And I think that's pretty cool about them. So what about us? I had the occasion to hear Dan Rogers speaking about Bible imagery. And the first thing he said was, we should not read the Bible for what it says, but for what it means. What do you think Dan meant by that?
I was with you, so I feel like I might be
cheating. You're cheating. You're cheating. Yeah. Pastors' wives cannot answer questions in church because you know all the answers. Yeah. It's not fair. What do you think Dan meant by this? Go ahead, brother.
You know, sometimes when we look at the beer English, turn the other cheek.
Mm-hmm.
I have heard a lot of people say, if someone hit you on the, or they slap you on the face, you put the next jaw to get another slap.
Mm-hmm.
But in today's society, that's brutality.
Mm-hmm.
And Christians should not stay and get to be brutalized.
Yes.
But wisdom, I realize, is what you use.
Yes.
You get out of the area, or say a kind word, or at least love conquers all. So mm-hmm. you have the use of wisdom.
Right.
Leave the zone, but don't stay there and get beat up.
Mm-hmm. That's right. If we just read the Bible all the time for exactly what it says, sometimes Jesus spoke figuratively. Mm-hmm. Often he did. Mm-hmm. Right. Sometimes there's a third of the Bible's poetry. Did you know God was a poet? It's pretty cool, right? He loves poetry. Right? So if we take the Bible literally, it's going to cause us to do some really strange things. Especially if you start reading Song of Solomon, you'll be doing some. Come hunt in my mountains. Whoa, what is going on? What is being talked about right now? Right? So we can't just read everything literally. Not to say that there aren't literal statements in the Bible, things that we should take literally, but how do we know the difference? This is where good study habits come in. We need to read the Bible not for what it says, but for what it means. Things like Genesis 1 jam a lot of people up, mess with people, because they're trying to cram science and what they, you know. It's a theological book. Read it for what it means. What is Moses trying to say about God and who God is and who we are? That's the most important thing. We read the Bible for what it means, not for what it says. You follow? Okay. I'm going to try to make this a little bit more clear. Okay, so here's some ways to understand a passage. You want to identify the author and his purpose for writing the book. Who wrote the book? Whose voice are we listening to? Why did they write their book? As we said earlier, the writers of the Bible had agendas. They are not reporters. They are not impartial. They had a reason for writing their book. They had a point of view and a perspective, and that's why they wrote. Even the stories we have of Jesus, the four Gospels, each one of the Gospel writers had a very different reason for writing their book. All true, all complementary. They all work. Different agendas. Right? So it's important to know who the author is and their purpose for writing the book. Look at the passage in more than one translation. I'm going to say a bit about Bibles in a second, but different translations will say, put the phrase that you're looking at, the passage that you're looking at differently. And you want to have different kinds of Bibles. I'll talk about that in just a second. You want to look at that same passage in different kinds of Bibles. Now, this is what I do when I'm having a hard time understanding or I want to get a deeper understanding. I'm not saying this is what you do all the time. You touch the Bible. Although it wouldn't be bad. If you got that kind of time on your hands, praise God. I typically don't. Between my dog and my kids, I'm lucky to get 10 minutes of uninterrupted time. All right, understand the historical setting, the setting of the action of the passage. So whatever is going on in what you're reading, what's going on for those people? Right, find out what the culture was like, find out what's going on. But also identify the book's intended audience and their historical setting. So for instance, John writes his book, we think towards the end of the first century. But he's talking about action towards the beginning of the first century. Who he's writing his book for is not the people that he's writing about, right? He's writing his book for the people that are his audience at his time. And so that sheds light into what stories he includes. Right? John's audience, when you understand who John's audience is, what he chooses, the stories he chooses to share about Jesus, they make much more sense. You understand what he's driving at. You with me? Please raise your hand and stop me if you're like, what? All right, it'll be okay. All right, research how the audience may have understood the passage. As much as you can, we want to understand what the author is saying from the perspective of those he's writing to. Right? So, again, like I have people say things like, you know, the Bible doesn't say anything about marijuana. And I say, marijuana doesn't grow in the Middle East. So, needs more tropical climate. So, you're not going to hear too much about marijuana in the Bible. That doesn't mean the Bible doesn't have something to say about getting high.
Right. Absolutely.
Right? So, you got to put yourself in the place of the audience, and you can't have modern eyes. You have to say, okay, how did the audience receive this? And then, since we are human, say, okay, what could that say to us now? How can we bring that current? So understand the main point the author is trying to make in the passage. So this is the perfect example of this is, remember that story Jesus told about there's a rich guy, and Lazarus, who was poor, a beggar. The rich man just like, Lord, thank you for not making me broke and poor like this fool over here, right? And then they die, and they get ushered away, and the poor man is in Abraham's bosom, right? Abraham's just holding him like a little baby. And the rich man's in hell, right? And the rich man's like, what's up with this? This is messed up, man. God, can't you let me in? Can I just tell him just to bring a drop of water and put it on my tongue, right? And so then the parable goes on and on and on and on. But the main point about what Jesus was trying to make is how do we view those less fortunate? The things that we think make you successful and well-known ain't necessarily so, mm-hmm. right? And he's asking people to take a hard look at their priorities and what they think is important. That's what the Bible writer was trying to say. Mm-hmm. Now, what some people do is take that as a doctrine of hell. Mm-hmm. That's not what he was trying to say. Okay. Yeah. There are places where Jesus does talk directly about hell, mm-hmm. and we could take that and put that towards our doctrine of hell. But to take a story that says, let me tell you a parable, let me tell you a story to illustrate a point, and use that to construct our doctrine of hell, that just doesn't work. All right, we're not standing on a firm foundation then. Understanding. You with me?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, just from the things I've experienced personally as a Christian, as an African-American woman, there's been interesting things that I've read. So, for example, I really grappled a lot with some of the things that Paul has said about women, like really significantly struggled. And then also, too, just really not so much for me, but more so I have a lot of relatives who just outright reject Christianity because they look at historically how it was used as a part of enslavement. And so that piece too, if you just take a scripture in isolation, be like, oh, slaves, be obedient to your masters, and then the way that that was used, you know, around the foundation of this country, that's not what God intended to have happen.
That's right.
That scripture. So I think that's kind of like some of the examples too. It's like we need to understand why Paul said what he said about women in that context and at that time, and what does that mean for us nowadays?
Yeah.
And the same thing too about, you know, like how people who are enslaved and what was enslavement back then, and what does that really mean?
Yeah. That's another perfect example. Slavery to folks back then meant something very different. There's nothing been or has never been anything like the American slave trade.
Oh.
Nothing. Yeah. Right? So when they say slavery, they're talking about basically having a job. I mean, that's what we're
saying.
Maybe having some debts. You're talking about like 90% of the public right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what they're talking about. But if we read it with our modern eyes, we think of something very different.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it's very important to follow these steps. Any other comments, questions, thoughts?
Well, I was thinking about persecution now because I've heard that some people are locked up in cells these days because they're a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
I heard that from a pastor one time.
In some places, yeah, you can get a lot of trouble for being a Christian.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, what is the difference between that and persecution and slavery? You know. Now, to me, there's no difference.
Well, what some folks are going through and what we read about, there isn't a lot of difference. It's similar.
I'm not trying to change the subject, but I just happened to think about it.
But again, we have to the different words of the Bible, different authors use them in different ways. You know, we can't just say the way persecution appears in one book is the same way we need to read it in another. You know, again, it's very important to pay attention to who the author is, what they're trying to say, right? And so you might be sitting here and say, you know, this is, how do we make sense of any of this? Well, that's a nice segue to what we're going to talk about next.
Well, actually, I have a point.
Oh, yeah, please go ahead, Connie.
In terms of, I know you're setting up something.
Now, this is it. I was about to cut. I'm done.
But I know there was a period of time where I could not read Psalms. It made absolutely no sense to me. None of it. And then I was 20-something.
Yes.
Yeah.
It did. When I got 40-something, I could then read Psalms.
Oh, man.
For me personally.
Man. Mm-hmm. Psalms.
When everything's going happy, happy, joy, joy, in your 20s, you're young, your new skin is developing,
your
growing,
yeah.
Growing. Psalms doesn't make sense.
Yes.
You haven't been through anything.
Okay, yes.
Maybe there might be some people who have.
Yeah.
Yes.
Have gone through a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But for me, it was like, you know, life was grand and great and I was going.
Yeah. That's the book I go to when I'm going through a hard time.
Yeah.
Because David got it, man. David got it.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, yes, man. He's speaking my language. I'm so messed up right now, man. Right? And it's true. And different books make sense to you. And you have a different relationship with them at different times.
Mm-hmm.
It's part of the beauty and wonderfulness
and
of the Bible.
And I think that might get lost in reading the Bible, is that it grows with you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. As you grow, it grows with you. Although, when you're reading it, because I read a scripture, and I'm like, I know I read that 5 years ago, and it didn't say that.
Yes. Yes.
It's
true. It's true. It's alive.
Mm-hmm.
It has. You can have discussions with the Bible, and it says, all right, you were ready for this, let me tell you this now.
Yeah.
Right.
I was going to say too, along the same lines as what Connie just said, Proverbs looked very different to me as a child than it does to me now as a parent.
Oh yeah.
Because as a kid I was like, oh,
whatever,
wisdom and all these like rules and stuff. And then as a parent, I'm just like, yes.
Yeah, preach.
Read this. Read
preach
this.
That, Solomon. Say that.
Come here, child.
It's true. It's true. It's the richness of the word. Go ahead, brother.
I also think to add to what they're saying, the level of the Spirit giving you an understanding as you get older, the same thing you read 20 years ago, it's jump up. As a matter of fact, some of the teachings that have been taking place, it's opening my mind to what they said. Very same passages that I read 5-6 times.
That's right.
And I think because of the level of sticking to want to know more, and the Spirit is opening up my mind.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
When I was growing up, we always were staunch SDA. Mm. And we'd have Bible studies on Friday nights. And for some reason, my mother would always let me go into Revelation.
Oh no.
I said, how could there be a God? Innocent children. And so mother says, how innocent were you this week? What did you might have beaten up somebody or something. But it's nothing to put you in fire for, and all these things are burning. Once I looked up and there was a smile on my mother's face, like she was enjoying. I said, "You're enjoying the fact that I'm going to be burning in fire and such forth." And God doesn't think of little children. So then she explained it to me. Well, you've got to do better this week, and you've got to do better that week, and then God will take that into consideration.
Oh no!
Other than that, the four horsemen are going to come for you.
Oh, man.
Discipline?
It explains a lot about.
It does. It does. I tell new believers, just leave that book alone. Just.
It could terrify you.
If you go your whole life without reading Book of Revelation, you'll be okay. You know, just leave that book alone, at least for now. Right? Just leave that alone. Man, I saw, I used to watch the World Tomorrow telecast back in the day, and they had this one with the four horsemen, and they did a full, like, Hollywood production. Man, as a kid, I had nightmares for weeks. They were riding, and the death one came, and he's like, ah, and his mouth opened, like, ah! I'm scared.
I'll be a good kid.
I thought the horsemen were coming for me.
Yeah.
It's true, man. Oh. It could get, yeah, the beast. I mean, what's up with that? All kind of horns? A crazy woman riding it? What in the world's going on?
See, now, you talk about some marijuana or weed.
Now,
it's true. John was eating out there.
I'm saying, John was out, man. Because it says when he first started hearing stuff, he passed out. He's like, he's like a man dead. They had to revive John and be like, John, it's going to be all right. He's like, I don't want to see this, man. This is crazy. And he's like, write it down. He's like, all right, write it down. I'm not happy about it. Right? You know that was some crazy. So Bible imagery is thick in Revelation. And unless you know you got your feet on the ground with some Bible imagery, you're going to get messed up. And we're going to end up with like movies like Left Behind. Listen, that's entertaining. It's not going to be like that. Not only. How many people read Left Behind or watched that movie?
Yeah.
Good. Don't. Just leave it alone.
Somebody who read that book and then they got more into religion after that. They got into a church.
But that's not God's not a God of fear. You know, God's not a God that say, you know. I mean, sometimes it happens like that. You know, there's about passage that says the fear of God is the beginning of knowledge, but that can't be the basis of your religion.
Yeah,
I'm scared. I'm fitting to die. Yeah, it's not a relationship. All right.
I'm scared.
That's what it is. I'm scared that God's going to kill me and put me in hell. So let me go to church. That's not what he wants from us. All right, so here's some useful tools. All those things that I said that you got to pay attention to, there are wonderful people that have already thought about that, and they have summarized it for you. Glory to God. You think I'm just, you know, I don't know this stuff. I mean, I read a book, and they tell me, oh, okay, good, and that's what I'll preach. You know? All right, so a study Bible. Get yourself a real good study Bible. All right, I got a Nelson's. I love it. It's very, very good. Ryrie has a good one, Zondervan, you know, just get yourself a nice, good study Bible.
Christian bookstore has that.
Yeah, yeah. CBD, Christian Book Distributors, twice a year they have a big sale. What you can buy from there is just ridiculous.
It's not that far away.
They don't have it anymore? But they advertise. They give me an advertisement.
Well, maybe the warehouse.
Do it online now.
Do it online. Okay, maybe that's what it is. Yeah.
You can't go into the warehouse.
Can't go to the warehouse. I used to roll up with a big suitcase and just pile up.
I have shelves of stuff
I haven't
even read yet.
What'd you say?
I have shelves of stuff from there I haven't even read yet.
I know, man. You can make out. But at least the online sale, that should be good. I got an average. They still do that. You know, if you don't have a lot of money, wait for that to come around. They usually, like, at least half off or, you know, something like that. You can get a really, really good Bible for not a lot of money. And what that will do is verse by verse give you some of the stuff that I'm talking about. And every time they introduce a book, they give you the author, the date, the setting, right there, right? And just you let that influence how you read what happens next. Now, sometimes you come to a hard scripture and need some Bible commentary. You got to be careful about what Bible commentary, and if you want to talk about that, I could be somewhat helpful with that, because you want to make sure you're having the commentary of someone who believes similar things as you believe. Otherwise, you're going to, you know, there's some weird stuff out there. So you just want to be careful with that. But, and you want to, you know, there's a lot of, you know, Matthew Henry and stuff like that. There's some older stuff, but there's more modern commentary. And I would lean towards something more modern. So Bible dictionaries, I got myself a nice big color one. I like it because the pictures help. Because I've never been to the Middle East. So knowing a little bit about what the Middle East looks like, and it's good. So you might want to get a Bible dictionary. For those of you who are listening to me, I'm holding up books. That's why I got to come to church. That's why I got to come here, because you membership has privileges. A concordance. A lot of times, you know, like I use my Kindle for my Bible. I got a concordance right plugged in. I just press the word, and boom, I get all the Greek, Hebrew, everything right there. So you can get that. There's a bunch of websites, these websites down here, that has a lot of these other resources in it, but for your concordance, you can use a website. You don't have to pay a cent. So Bible Gateway, Blue Letter Bible, both of those. Concordances are where you can search out a particular word or phrase in the Bible, so you can just plug it into the search, and it'll tell you all the passages where that is. Again, it's good to keep in mind a little bit of Greek and Hebrew, and both these websites will give you some of that as well to make sure you're following the same word. Because a word in English could be multiple words in other languages, and you want to make sure you're looking at the right word. Does that make sense? Okay. Books by Trinitarian-leaning authors. This is a really good one. I got Simply Jesus. So it talks about how Jesus was received by the folks, like really what it means to have the Messiah come. Like, how did the Jews think about Messiah? And where those ideas come from, and how do they receive Jesus and his teaching? It says a new vision of who he was, what he did, and why he matters. Very cool book, N.T. Wright. Here's some Bible handbooks up here that I brought, that I use. And here's another book, How to Read the Bible for All It's Worth. This is gold if you want to really start to know this stuff. So this is a really good book for that. This is all the books I was willing to bring, because I know how some of you are. You might rob me. I might leave here with just like a post-it note that used to be a bookmark. And I don't know, where are my books? I'm just kidding. If you want to borrow something on here, I'll be happy to lend it to you. Because I want us all to grow. I want us all to learn. I want us all to be hungry for the Word. And to think that you can just pick up the Bible and read it and understand everything, it's not how it is. We all need help. Amen? All right. Just a couple of quick words. We're running out of time, but I know that I need to say this. Not all Bibles are the same. There's sort of three basic categories of Bibles. There's close to literal. So the translation of it is trying to be as close to what the literal words are in Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic, I guess. So it could get a little bit dicey because the idioms are not translated. So there are idioms that are in original language that don't mean what they literally say, but we wouldn't necessarily know that because they're idioms. right? So that's the good and bad with close to literal. Another one is the functional equivalent, where they kind of try to modernize the translation and put it in ways that we would understand. But again, some of the punch is often lost. Some of the punch of the original language is lost. And then there's the medium that tries to blend the two. It tries to have the punch of the close to literal with the readability of the functional equivalent. And you can look to see your Bible. I don't know all these letters. I know most of them. That's why we stick with the NIV when we're in church, because it's a kind of middle of the road type translation. And that's why I read from it. But when I study, I might jump to one of these other ones. So when you're trying to unlock the meaning of a passage, it's good to look at it in each one of these types of Bibles. Right? Do you understand what I'm saying? So you get close to literal, get the functional equivalent, you get somewhere in the middle.
There's a parallel bind.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, they have parallel Bibles that allow you to look at the same passage in multiple translations. Those are great.
I got one of those in Pasadena when the campus was opening.
Yeah.
And when I was looking at Matthew, one of the scriptures, my brother was, he just couldn't believe it. I looked at one of the scriptures, but there was some things missing out of it, out of one of the scriptures that he said.
Oh, I'm glad you brought that up, because that's what we're going to talk about next. Now, if that's why I'm putting this in here, because you might look at more than one Bible. Say you take, like I do, I got a King James, and I look at that and the NIV, and there's some passages missing. Yes. And I'm like, what in the world's going on here? It's like, it is all a sham. Oh, man. Right? Nope. Just relax. Take a breath. Right? They're manuscripts. There's a difference in manuscripts. So the books of the New Testament were written towards the end of the first century, and we have about 5,300 manuscripts, right? That's a lot. 24,000 in total, including Latin and other languages. The Bible is the most documented ancient text on the planet. There's nothing even close. The closest one is the Iliad with 600-something remaining manuscripts. They're a joke compared to the Bible. Bible wrecks it, right? So the earliest manuscripts date back to the 4th century, which is about 250 to 300 years after the original book was written. And so the earlier the manuscript was written tends to be the more accurate, right? The longer from the action, the original book that we take, most likely the less accurate that manuscript is. Because remember, these things are copied by hand. There are no Xerox copiers. So copy errors and other things happen. Do you understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So if I base my Bible translation from a more modern manuscript, it's going to be less reliable than a Bible translation based on an earlier manuscript. You with me? At the time, say, for instance, the New King James was written, which is a long time ago, they had access to more later manuscripts. Since it was written, we discovered more. Right? And more modern translations are based on earlier manuscripts. So there are some things that are in the later manuscripts that weren't in the earlier manuscripts. So in situations like that, like the NIV, they drop those verses and they say, okay, here's what some manuscripts say. Right? But that wasn't in some of the earlier manuscripts. That's why some Bibles have scriptures and passages that others do not. Now, again, remember getting back to the infallibility versus inerrancy, right? When we say that the Bible's infallible, we can allow for differences like that. That's okay, because those things that are missing or not do not at all alter the overall doctrine of the Bible. You with me? Questions on that? Don't get jammed up, and don't let people say crazy things to you. Okay, so here's the bottom line, tying it all together. How do we get the most out of the Bible? Jesus is the interpretive key of all scripture. The Bible helps us relate to God and others, but is not a substitute for a relationship with God. The Bible is a life-giving book. However, we need to use the Bible as it was intended and for the purposes for which it was created. The Bible provides us with a way to spend time with God and should be approached with that perspective. The Bible can be hard to understand, so we should get help in reading it for what it means. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Lord, you are so good. We thank you for this incredible book, the Bible, and we thank you that it's a life-giving book, Lord God. And with it, we can learn more about you. We can hear the witness of saints that's come before us, and we can see your revelation, Lord God. Please bless us to use that book in the way it was intended. Let it be a blessing to us, and let it accomplish what it was created for, and that is to draw us into relationship with you. We love you so much. We give you the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.